Welcome to Modern Latin America in 15 minutes. My name is Dr. Kim Richardson, and today we are going to discuss very briefly Bolivia. This is a 15-minute lecture, but will actually be a little bit less than 15 minutes because what I wanted to emphasize is that in 1940s, two things occurred at the same time after World War II. And number one, with the advent of nuclear weapons and everything, the U.S. policy was covert operations, too often than not. And so Guatemala is a great example of overthrowing the government covertly. But what about Bolivia? Bolivia is a great example of shooting yourself in the foot, the government being overthrown by itself, by its own incompetency, as we're going to see here. The other thing I wanted to emphasize is that people are turning to revolution as a way of changing, altering the patterns of the past, trying to make things better. You got two choices here, reform or revolution. This case, it's revolution that fails. Now that we have the beginning and the end, let's say. Last time we talked about Guatemala. Today we'll talk about Bolivia. Bolivia hadn't always been a landlocked country, but by the 20th century, it was indeed. And in the 20th century, it participated in the export agriculture, neocolonialism, especially with tin. By the 1940s, both Guatemala and Bolivia were made up of largely indigenous peoples. 75% of Guatemalans, 75% of Bolivians claim to be indigenous. And those that are not indigenous claim to be mestizos above all else, right? Mixed race. There are some that claim not to be, but above all else, they are. Again, the major export is tin at this time, whereas in Guatemala, it was bananas. Well, as the Great Depression hit, and of course, everybody blames democracy or blames whatever for the economic collapse, many people turn to dictatorships. In this case, they turn to war. See, what happens is that in this area called the Chaco, the Gran Chaco, oil was discovered. And both Bolivia and Paraguay had laid claims to this territory here for many decades. But now there's more of a reason to fight over this territory now that oil was discovered. And the 20th century, by the 1930s, it's evident that oil is going to be a vital concern to all of these countries. I mean, take the example of Mexico that's becoming rich at this time because of the oil discoveries and exports. So they go to war, the Chaco War from 1932 to 1935. And if you look at this, Paraguay wins. Wait, Bolivia is much bigger than Paraguay and Bolivia loses? What the heck could cause the loss of this war by Bolivia? Well, major results of this war, number one, of course, well, Bolivia lost. Number two, they began to blame international oil companies like Standard Oil. Since that oil was discovered there, perhaps the oil companies was trying to placate one side off the other side. It's their fault. And number three, you see a rise of a whole bunch of disgruntled peoples. Middle class, they're very disgruntled that they're lost. Nobody's happy when they lose a war. Students are idealists. They're especially disgruntled, and they're in a position to be reading up on why and whatnot and be influenced. Army officers and everybody else, they are disgruntled. They're upset. Many of these people turn to Marxist doctrines. There's other ways too, but many of them say, well, maybe perhaps we should choose Marxist reform as a way to alter these patterns of dependency and neocolonialism. Well, if they are advocating Marxism, they will probably join this new political party called the National Revolutionary Movement, the MNR. The head of this movement is going to be Victor Paz Estenssoro. Now, it's not going to be immediately, but eventually, Victor Paz Estenssoro, as head of the National Revolutionary Movement, is going to be elected president of Bolivia, 1951. Now, he's elected president, but that does not mean that the military is going to let him take the office, even though he was democratically elected. So they say, no way at all. Well, the masses that supported him, his supporters, they decided to rise up in rebellion. It's kind of like when Juan Perón was fired, and the masses in October of 1945 rose up as well in support of him. So they overtook. He was elected democratically the president, but he took office by overthrowing the military thanks to this uprising. He took office anyway. Once he takes office, now the revolution can begin, right? Well, all of the economy seemed to be dependent on tin mines, and the tin mines, the major export, were monopolized by the Pachinos, Hochschilds, and the Aramayo families. So all you need to do then is to nationalize the tin mines, right? Whereas in Guatemala, they nationalized the land, the banana lands, that were owned by foreigners. Here they nationalized lands that are owned by Bolivians themselves. So it's a little bit different in this case. But they nationalized it in 1952. Now again, I think I had hinted at this in the last discussion. The only nationalized company I am familiar with in the United States is USPS, United States Postal Service, which is owned by the federal government, right? That's the same thing here. It's going to be run by the federal government. Well, if this is a revolution, remember that the revolution was being fought now. It's not a super bloody revolution like Mexico, but it's still being fought and carried out over land, labor, and education reform. All three of these play a vital concern in this Bolivian revolution. And in the countryside, therefore, many other people said, yes, now that we are taking control of our own properties and land and everything, we are going to kick out the landowners and take the land from them. So there's this land grabbing in the countryside. Well, he said, well, hold on a second. I was going to do this, but not yet. I want to do it slowly and methodically, right? Remember that image that I keep showing of the horse rider that's riding the horse called Revolution downhill. If you go too fast, it could stumble and fall. But they've already taken the land, so he passes the land reform law in August of 1953 and begins to redistribute land. By 1960, 60,000 families received new plots of land. So in other words, the revolution here, land reform is one of the key aspects, and it's being carried out. Economic independence is another key aspect, and it's being carried out. 1952 to 1956, that's officially when Victor Paz Estenssoro is president. After 1956, carrying out these reforms, he steps down. Hernán Siles carries on the tradition of reforms. This is the Bolivian Revolution. He steps down in 1960. That means it's a democracy, right? And Victor Paz Estenssoro comes back to power. But remember, my key aspect, what is a democracy, means that after your term of office ends, you leave. You go away. 1964, he wants to rewrite the Constitution so that he can stay. That's not a democracy. And the military took that as their opportunity to overthrow him. Darn it, what is going on now? Now the military is back in power. What happened to the revolution? By trying to change the Constitution, he shot himself in the foot. By trying to change the Constitution, there will be no CIA covert operation here. It's going to come to an end. How are they going to survive then, right? They're going to retake back the land, and it's going to be small plots of land people have. How are they going to survive? Well, they turn to cocaine. By 1987, cocaine industry in Bolivia was the largest in the world. The nation's primary export. Not tin anymore. Not anything else. Well, they have others, but this is the primary. You know? All right. Cocaine. After 64, it's going to come a period of the opposite of revolution, right? Trying to go back on this. But in 1985, he's going to be re-elected as president. But by this time, he's no revolutionary at all, and the revolution comes to an end. Really came to an end in 1964. You see that in 1964, how it comes to an end when the military takes over again, right? The famous Che Guevara, right? He wants to go back down into Bolivia to fight the fight, to keep the revolution going. But he's captured and assassinated by the military, with the help, of course, in this case, of the United States Armed Forces, unofficially, of course. What are we going to do? During 1 year, the United States provides up to a third of the national budget of Bolivia. Why? Trade and security. They're communists, so we're going to try to provide part of their budget to fight against communism. But it's interesting, especially in the 1980s. Some of us remember living through this, the 1980s. They're paying so much money to Bolivia to fight against the war on drugs. But if drugs were the primary export, then fighting against drugs is not going to solve anything. So they're going to take the money and pretend to fight. Extreme poverty is caused by extreme wealth. Revolution, in this case, was the result. But revolution running downhill too fast can not be tripped by somebody else, but trip itself. Now, maybe it's not because it was running too fast. Maybe it's because Victor Paz and Soto just said, oh, I give up, or whatever. It collapses on its own. Very quickly, 10 minutes, this is Modern Latin America, and that was the Bolivian Revolution.